हरे कृष्ण। इन द नाइन्थ चैप्टर ऑफ भगवद गीता सो फार वी हैव कवर्ड द फर्स्ट 25 श्लोकस। इन द फर्स्ट 3 श्लोकस वी हैव सीन हाउ कृष्णा वाज ग्लोरिफाइंग द नॉलेज दैट ही इज गोइंग टू डिस्क्राइब। एंड इन द नेक्स्ट 6 श्लोकस फ्रॉम श्लोका नंबर 4 to 10 7 श्लोकस वी हैव सीन कृष्णस ऐश्वर्य ज्ञान, हाउ कृष्णा इज एक्सप्लेनिंग हिज ओन एनर्जीज, how his energies are functioning. Then we have seen different types of worships, direct and indirect worships of Krishna. Krishna described about the impersonalistic people, foolish people who fail to understand him, and Viratrup worshippers. And he also described about demigod worshippers. Like that Krishna described various types of worshippers. Now, in the 25th shloka, which we discussed the last, Yanti deva vratan devan pitran yanti pitruvrata bhutani yanti bhutejya yanti majjyapi nopima majjyapi. So, Krishna describes that those who worship the demigods will go to demigod planets, those who worship forefathers, they will go to their planets, and those who worship Krishna will go to Krishna's planet. And those who go to Krishna's planet need not undergo repeated cycle of birth and death. Means they need not come back to this material world. So he said like that. But what enables one to go to Krishna's planet? It is the process of bhakti yoga. Pure devotional service or ananya bhakti that enables a sincere devotee to enter Krishna loka. In the last section of this chapter, text number 26 to 34, Krishna describes the glories of Krishna bhakti, pure bhakti. Let's begin this last section, 26th shloka. Patram pushpam phalam toyam,
patram pushpam phalam toyam,
yome bhaktya prayachate,
yome bhakta prayachate,
tadaham bhakti upahritam,
tadaham bhakti upahritam,
ashnami prayatatmanah,
ashnami prayatatmanah.
Patram pushpam phalam toyam, four things. Krishna says, one who offers me patram, some leaf, pushpam, flower, phalam, a fruit, toyam, little water. Yome bhaktya prayachati, and such an offering has to be made with bhakti. If with love and devotion, if somebody offers me a leaf or a flower or a fruit or little water also, tadaham bhakti upahritam, that kind of offering which is made with pure love and devotion is acceptable by me. Ashnami prayatatmanah means I will accept that offering. Ashnami literally means eating, but in this context ashnami, you cannot offer, you may not eat a flower, you may not eat water, but Krishna uses the word ashnami out of his intense eagerness to accept whatever the devotee is offering. So when a devotee is offering something with a genuine consciousness, devotional consciousness, Krishna becomes very enthusiastic and eager to accept such an offering which is made with love. And this beautiful shloka also indicates that love is the only qualification for us to perform bhakti. The word bhakti comes in, comes two times in this shloka. Yome bhaktya prayachati, tadaham bhakti upahritam. Okay. So bhakti or love and devotion, affection, this is the only quality that Krishna is impressed with. The magnitude of your offerings are not as important as the attitude behind those offerings. If someone is very wealthy, if someone is very rich person, he has so many resources, so much of manpower, so much of influence, certainly he may make magnificent offerings to the Lord, no doubt. But this shloka describes the simplicity of bhakti yoga, that you don't need to be a rich man to worship Krishna. Even if you are the most downtrodden, very poorest person also, still you can afford a flower, you can afford little water. Can't you offer little water to Krishna? So even the poorest person also can serve Krishna, can do bhakti to Krishna, provided the poor person has some love for Krishna. Okay, that's what Krishna describes in this shloka. So no one is bad from bhakti because one does not have some material resources or knowledge or anything like that. What Krishna needs is only devotion. And the sign of purity of one's bhakti there is that one should not have any motivations behind such an offering. So Krishna says here, bhaktya prayachati tadaham bhakti upahritam. So what is offered with love, I accept. So in that love, no personal motivations, no selfish agendas. That is an ahaituki bhakti. Ahaituki apratihata yayatma suprasidati. When the bhakti is ahaituki, when the bhakti is offered to Krishna without any material expectations in return, without desiring any material boons or benedictions, without any other material benefits, then Krishna is very happy to reciprocate with such devotion. So he will not, a devotee is a person who renders service to Krishna without any motivations, and he will not give up service to Krishna at any time, under any conditions. So such a bhakti is also apratihata bhakti. Apratihata means uninterrupted devotional service. Ahaituki means unmotivated devotional service. So when Krishna is using the words bhakti here twice, so that uninterrupted bhakti and unmotivated bhakti are included in this bhakti. No breaks in your bhakti. Oh, I don't have money, I cannot worship Krishna. You have some leaf, you can offer it to Krishna. You have some flowers in your garden, you can offer them to Krishna. So, and another important aspect of this shloka is that bhakti is the only means to approach Krishna. Okay, I have so much wealth, I have so much knowledge, I have so much manpower, resources and influence. Can I be considered a pure devotee? No, not necessarily. In fact, sometimes such great opulence on a material plane could be a disqualification to perform bhakti, as Kunti says. Janmaishwarya Shruta Shri Bhir Edhamana Madah Puman Naiva Arhati Abhidhatum Vai Tvam Akinchana Gocharam. So Janma, high birth, Aishwarya, lot of opulence, Shruta, education, Shri, beauty. So Janmaishwarya Shruta Shri Bhir Edhamana Madah Puman, if someone is intoxicated by these four qualities, such a person may be disqualified from bhakti also. Having those qualities, having high birth or education or beauty or wealth is not wrong. But being puffed up of these four things, that is wrong. If one is puffed up or intoxicated by these four material qualifications, it's very difficult to attain Krishna's mercy. Kunti says, Tvam akinchana gocharam. Krishna is easily accessible and approachable and available to people who are akinchanas. Akinchana means very poor people, materially impoverished people. That does not mean all poor people are pure devotees and all wealthy people are, you know, demons. That's not the message there. Akinchana is basically in the mood. So in Bhagavatam we see Ambarish Maharaj is an emperor, Yudhishthir Maharaj, Parikshit Maharaj, Prithu Maharaj, Prachetas, who else? Prahlad Maharaj, Dhruva Maharaj, these are all Maharajas. Maharaj means they are all great devotees, they are all great kings. Means they don't have Janma, Ishwarya, Shruta, Shri. They have high birth definitely, they have beauty certainly, and they have a lot of wealth, influence, education, everything they have. But they are pure devotees because although they have all these material possessions, they don't have possessiveness. Having possessions is not a disqualification. Being possessive about those possessions is a disqualification. So if you don't have any possessions, you may not have possessiveness also. Okay, generally. And without such material possessiveness, even if you offer little flower or fruit or leaf to Krishna with devotion, Krishna is very happy to accept it. So it's not a costly or expensive affair to render service to Krishna. All you need is little flower, fruit. So Prabhupada writes, no other condition such as becoming a scholar, rich man, philosopher can induce Krishna to accept some offering. Okay, Krishna just reciprocates with the love and affection of devotee. So that attitude matters more than magnitude of your offering. Magnitude may be very small. If the attitude is pure, Krishna is very eager to accept the offering. So that is the simplicity of bhakti. Bhakti is very simple. Bhakti is very easy to render if one does not have motivations. What makes bhakti very complicated and complex is our complex mentalities. Okay, if someone is too speculative, someone is too selfish, too greedy, very lusty, or envious of other people, with all these mentalities, if one is trying to render service to Krishna, the service is always tinged with these negative qualities. One may render service to God with just to fulfill one's lusty desires, material desires for name, fame, prestige and a lot of wealth. Or someone may perform bhakti to take revenge on someone. Okay, many demigods are worshipped like that. They go to demigod, they worship the demigod, give me some weapon so that I can kill this fellow, my enemy. So with all these motivations, if there is no lust, there is no envy, no greed, no pride, and with such, without that big baggage, burden that we carry, without that, if we render bhakti to Krishna, without any expectation in return, it is so simple, so sublime, one can become a great object of Krishna's mercy. All Krishna wants is only love, nothing more. He has everything in the entire cosmic manifestation. Krishna is not a poor person. He is a very self-sufficient person. He doesn't need your patram. He doesn't need your pushpam. He doesn't need your toyam or phalam. He needs bhakti. So Krishna is just aspiring to see devotion in you. See love in your eyes when you see him. That's all he wants. What you offer to Krishna, it all depends on time, place and circumstances. Okay, how much you have access to. So circumstances are not very good, or you may be not very wealthy. You may not have certain resources. You may not be able to perform certain service in a certain way. Krishna wouldn't mind. You have love, sufficient for it. That's all I want. So that is the simplicity of bhakti yoga. Then, what if somebody cannot perform bhakti at this level? Now propose, you see, propose purport. Those who do not make an offering of their food, he says in the same verse, are verily eating sin. So Prabhupada refers to third chapter of Bhagavad Gita, where it is said that some people, they have a lot of resources, they have a lot of food, but they eat without offering the food to Krishna. Such people who are not expressing any gratitude to the Lord, they are verily eating only sin. So now, every mouthful is simply deepening their involvement in the complexities of material nature. Every mouthful. Krishna has given you all food. Whatever patram, pushpam, phalam, toyam is actually given to you by Krishna. Did you create water? Did you create food? Did you create all these vegetables? You may say, I am a farmer. I am only doing this. Yeah, as a farmer, you can put fertilizers, you can cultivate the land, you can till the land and all that. But did you create the seed? Did you create the sunshine? Did you create the soil?
Rain.
Create the rain? So you are, moment by moment, you are dependent on Krishna. And without showing any gratitude to Krishna by offering little food to Krishna, you are eating everything. So that is very ungrateful. Not being thankful to God. So that is very sinful. The impersonalist philosopher who wished to maintain that the absolute truth is without senses cannot comprehend this verse of Bhagavad Gita. To them, it is either a metaphor or proof of mundane character of Krishna. Anyways, you can go through all these elements of the purport. I explained the gist of the whole thing. So now, this 26th verse says the simplicity of bhakti, that Krishna accepts anything that is offered with devotion. And all he expects is only devotion, bhakti. What if one's devotion is not at this level? He may want to offer something to Krishna, but he does not have that pure bhakti, pure love, emotion, feelings towards Krishna. It's not that he is very eager to offer everything that he has to Krishna. Okay? So if one's bhakti is not on this level, what should he do? Whatever he has or whatever he does, he can just offer it to Krishna. Okay? Means you are unable to offer what Krishna wants, patram pushpam phalam doyam, with bhakti, mainly with bhakti. But whatever you have, you can offer to Krishna. I'll explain in deeper detail once we read the shloka. Yat karoshi yadashnasi,
yat karoshi yadashnasi,
yat juhoshi dadasi yat,
yat juhoshi dadasi
yat, yat tapasyasi kaunteya,
yat tapasyasi kaunteya,
tat kurushvama darpanam,
tat kurushvama darpanam.
Yat karoshi, whatever you do, yadashnasi, whatever you eat, whatever you do, whatever you eat, yat juhoshi dadasi yat, means whatever you sacrifice or give away. Dadasi means just offering charity or just giving away, giving up. Tya tapasyasi kaunteya, whatever austerities you do, tat kurushva madarpanam, do it as an offering to me. Means the activity that you are doing is not to please Krishna. You did not begin an activity to please Krishna. Basically you did whatever you did. Whatever you wanted to do, you did. Yat karoshi, to karna hai kar liya. Yadashnasi, whatever you want, you ate it. Whatever you wanted to give, you just gave it. Whatever you want to sacrifice or do the austerity, all that you did. On your own. So at the end, okay, let me offer everything to Krishna. Fine. So, now, when an activity, for example, simple example, say Krishna wants halwa. Okay. So, you went to the kitchen to make halwa to feed Krishna. So you got the suji, you got the ghee, then sugar, whatever may be the ingredients, dry fruits, whatever may be the ingredients, you just brought everything because Krishna wanted halwa, you are making halwa. So because you are making it for Krishna, knowing that Krishna wants it, even before making the halwa only, that is offered to Krishna. At every moment of your making, right from beginning of the task of cooking, till the end of taking the plate in front of Krishna, every moment you are making an offering to Krishna. But the second case is, that is the case of 9.26. The case of 9.27 is, you have say Mysore Pak or say Gulab Jamun with you. You wanted to eat Gulab Jamun. Today you have made Gulab Jamun. With all the necessary ingredients and everything that is needed, you just made. Okay. At the end, he felt, let me offer this to Krishna also. Okay? I made Gulab Jamun. Okay, let's offer this to Krishna also. He just offered to Krishna and then after that you eat. So, you did not ask whether Krishna wants Gulab Jamun or Halwa. You wanted to make Gulab Jamun, you made it. At the end, you just gave it. Okay? So, doing an activity, knowing that this activity pleases the Lord, is pure bhakti. This is what Krishna wants me to do. That is pure bhakti. Second stage is, this is what I want to do, but I want to offer this to Krishna also. Whatever I do, I am offering to Krishna. Whatever I make, I will offer to Krishna. That is second. Okay? At least if you can't do the first thing, do the second thing. So 9.27, Yat Karoshi Yadashnasi is not a pure bhakti verse. It is not ananya bhakti. It is not shuddha bhakti. It is a little compromise in devotion. There is devotional service in it because you are offering everything that you have to Krishna. You have made 100 Gulab Jamuns, 100 Gulab Jamuns you offer to Krishna. But you began the making of Gulab Jamun not with an intent to please Krishna but just with an intent to please yourself or please someone else. But when you know that this is what is pleasing to Krishna, then right from the beginning only that is offered to Krishna. Even before you perform the activity, again, you give a simple example, but it could be anything. It could be any activity under the realm of Varna and Ashrama, under whatever prescribed duties or other duties that you perform. Okay? So even before performing the activity is offered to Krishna in pure bhakti. But in this compromised or little lesser bhakti, 9.27, activity you have done according to your psychophysical nature, your preference, your choice, your taste, your mood, and at the end you offered everything to Krishna. That is also good. No doubt about it. Okay. So this is not ananya bhakti. That's why the word bhakti doesn't come in this verse. Yat karoshi, yad ashnashi, yad juhoshi, dadasiyat, yat tapasyasi kaunteya, tat kurushva madarpanam. Madarpanam is coming. Offer everything to me. But Krishna does not consider it pure bhakti. In the previous shloka, Krishna used the word bhakti twice. In this shloka, he did not use only. Okay. So, it is somewhat similar to karma yoga or nishkama karma yoga, because you are doing your activity and with detachment you are offering everything to Krishna. Somewhat similar to karma yoga. But it is better than karma yoga. It seems similar to karma yoga, but it is better than karma yoga. Okay? Because you may be doing activities even beyond the prescribed duties and you are offering this to Krishna. Okay? Even beyond the prescribed duties. In karma yoga, you do only prescribed duties. But in this shloka, you may do things which are beyond prescribed duties also, according to your preference and your offering to Krishna. That's one thing. Then, it may seem similar to Jnana Mishra Bhakti. Okay? Because it has abundant... Because the person who is doing this has knowledge of Atma and Paramatma. Oh, there is Krishna. There is soul. So I should offer things to Krishna, whatever I do. So that kind of understanding is there. So it may seem like Jnana Mishra Bhakti. But this 9.27 verse is better than Jnana Mishra Bhakti also. Because not only you have knowledge of Paramatma, you also have knowledge of Bhagavan. You know the specific sweetness and personal features of the Supreme Lord as well. Okay. So it is better than Karma Mishra Bhakti, it is better than Jnana Mishra Bhakti, but it is not pure Bhakti. Why? Just that one fact. You are doing something according to your preference and sincerely offering to Krishna. But you are not doing something which Krishna wants you to do. So the difference is, when you are doing something which Krishna wants you to do exclusively, the activity is offered before it is performed. But in this case, you are offering the results of the activity after performing the activity according to your choice. I want to offer this specific service to Krishna. I already have this, I want to offer it to you. That is wonderful, great, amazing. But better than that is, oh, Krishna wants this. Let me just extend myself to do this. Even if it is beyond my bandwidth, even if it is beyond my preference or whatever, I should neglect all these other considerations. Krishna wants this, let me do it. With devotion. With bhakti. So that's the difference. So, do it for me. This is called archana. Give it to me. And this means that all surplus money accumulated should be utilized in furthering the Krishna consciousness movement. Okay. 28th shloka. Shubha shubha phalai revam.
Shubha shubha phalai revam.
Moksha se karma bandhanaihi.
Moksha se karma bandhanaihi.
Sanyasa yoga yuktatma.
Sanyasa yoga yuktatma.
Vimukto vamu paishyasi.
Vimukto vamu paishyasi.
Can someone read the translation?
In this way, you will be freed from bondage to work and its auspicious and inauspicious result. With your mind fixed on me in this principle of renunciation, you will be liberated and come to me.
So Krishna describes the result of offering everything to Krishna. In the 27th shloka, Krishna recommended that whatever you do it as an offering to me. Tat kurushva madarpanam. Now Krishna is saying, what is the result of such an offering to Krishna? You will be freed from bondage. Okay, vimukto mamu paishyasi. Vimukto means you will be freed from bondage. And mamu paishyasi, you will attain me at the end of your life. That is also there. So you will be freed from bondage to karma, which is an obstacle to bhakti. And its auspicious and inauspicious results also. Shubha shubha phalai revam. When you do some karma, there is ashubha phala and there is shubha phala. Shubha means auspicious, good. Phala means result. So when you do karma, when you do some activity, there are auspicious results, there are inauspicious results. Sometimes piety is acquired, sometimes impiety is acquired, sin is acquired. So, but if you offer everything to Krishna, you will be relieved from that karma, the bondage, that Shubha Phala and Ashubha Phala. All the good and bad results of your activities are completely nullified for you if you offer everything to Krishna. Shubha Ashubha Phala Yireva Mokshase Karma Bandhanai. Is it clear? First line. Second line. Sanyasa Yoga Yuktatma Vimuktvamam Upaishyasi. And you will be rooted in Sanyasa Yoga, means the principle of renunciation. Yuktatma. So Sanyasa here is renunciation from matter. Sanyasa Yoga means, yoga means connection to spirit, you know that. Sanyasa is renunciation from matter. Okay? Now you can't get confused. Saying Karma Yoga we have, Jnana Yoga we have, Ashtanga Yoga we have, Bhakti Yoga. What is this? Sanyasa Yoga? Don't get confused. Sanyasa means detachment from matter. Yoga means attachment to the Supreme, linking with the Supreme. That's what we discussed all these days. So Sanyasa and Yoga, you should be detached from matter, you should be attached to the Supreme. Sanyasa Yoga Yuktatma. Okay, you are totally engaged or imbued with the spirit of renunciation from everything material and attachment to everything Supreme, attachment to the Supreme God. Sanyasa Yoga Yuktatma. If that is the case, then Vimukto, you will be freed from bondage. Mam Upaishyasi, and you will attain Krishna also. So this is how Krishna describes the results of offering everything to Krishna. So Yukta Vairagya, Prabhupada writes this concept in the purport. Yukta Vairagya is to act in Krishna consciousness under some superior direction. And the fruits are given to Krishna ultimately. Actions performed with such renounced spirit clean one's mind, and one gradually makes progress in spiritual realization and becomes completely surrendered to the Supreme Lord. So Yukta Vairagya means you are very smart and intelligent in your renunciation. So Sanyasa Yoga Yuktatma, Krishna said, Sanyasa is renunciation. In the name of renunciation, you can't just give up everything which you can be potentially used in Krishna's seva. If some object or if some person is, we can potentially use them in Krishna's seva, why to be detached from them in the name of renunciation, in the name of Sanyasa? So one should have the, one should know the art of utilizing everything in Krishna's service. But different people can do it to different extents. Okay, in the name of Yukta Vairagya, you cannot just come in contact with everything and anything without the necessary maturity to protect oneself from the entanglement of interaction with that matter. For example, when you are dealing with money, there could be unwanted desires to acquire, greed, to be greedy. So one should consciously understand that dealing with money could make me greedy, but let me deal with money to set a degree as much as it is required for Krishna's service, okay, and let me also be very cautious of this unnecessary quality of greed. So like that, in the name of Yukta Vairagya, one should not just take unnecessary risks in bhakti. At the same time, in the name of Vairagya, one cannot just give up things that can be potentially utilized in Krishna's service. Prabhupada writes, anyone who has no interest but to dedicate his life to the service of the Lord is called a sannyasi. So the real spirit of sannyasa is not just detachment from matter, it is attachment to spirit. Just detachment from matter without attachment to spirit is not appreciated. Means from minus you came to zero, but you should ultimately go to plus, positive. Okay, so bhakti is that. A person who is thus always engaged in the service of the Lord or is always thinking and planning how to serve the Lord is to be considered completely liberated at present. In the future, he is going back to Godhead also. He is above all materialistic criticism, just as Krishna is above all criticism. Okay. So 29th shloka. Is this clear? Up to 20th shloka? 29th shloka. समोहं सर्वभूतेषु
समोहं सर्वभूतेषु
न मे द्वेष्योऽस्ति न प्रियः
न मे द्वेष्योऽस्ति न प्रियः
ये भजन्ति तु मां भक्त्या
ये भजन्ति तु मां भक्त्या
मयि ते तेषु तेषु चाप्यहम्
मयि ते तेषु चाप्यहम्
दिस् इस् अनदर् इम्पोर्टेण्ट् श्लोक अगेन् डिस्क्रैबिङ्ग् द क्वालिटि आफ् भक्ति सो दिस् इस् होल् भक्ति सेक्षन् 26 to 34 of this chapter, this some 8-9 verses, they are describing pure bhakti. 9.26, he described pure bhakti, ananya bhakti, patram pushpam phalantoyam. If one is not ready for that pure bhakti, he will give a second alternative, that is doing everything as an offering to Krishna. And what is the result of doing that? 28th verse he said. One can go back to Godhead also, by that also. Eventually they will develop pure bhakti. Now, 29th shloka, Krishna describes how he is very specially inclined towards his devotee. Okay. Although Krishna is equal to everyone, samoham sarva bhuteshu. Sama means equal. Aham means me. Sarva bhuteshu means all living entities. Krishna says, I am equal to all the living entities. Samoham sarva bhuteshu. Name dveshyosti na priyaha. Name dveshyasya means I don't envy anyone. Na priyaha. I don't become partial to someone or I don't hold someone very dear to me. Right? So, I don't have any special partiality towards someone. Nor am I inimical to someone. But, ye bhajinti tu. Tu means but. Ye bhajinti tu maam bhaktya. Again, the word bhaktya goes to 26th shloka. Yo me bhaktya prayachati. Tadaham bhakti upahritam. So if someone is worshipping me with bhakti, okay, ye bhajinti tu maam bhaktya, mayi te teshu cha api aham. I am there in him and he is there in me. So he just enters my heart and I enter his heart. Our relationship is so deep. What is this? Krishna is making two contradictory statements within one shloka. I am equal to everyone, I am not partial to anyone, but I am partial to my devotees. So it's very natural. Krishna is not partial or impartial. Krishna is basically reciprocating with the mood of a devotee, mood of anyone who is approaching him. Simple, in a classroom, the teacher is addressing say 100 students. And teacher is giving the same lesson to all the 100 students. Okay, there is no partiality there. There is no enmity towards any student. Same lecture. It's not that teacher is saying, oh, you student, you should close your eyes. Okay. I'll give the lecture in this five students' ears only. No, when in the classroom, everybody is sitting and the teacher is giving class to everybody. But there are some students who go to the teacher and ask for deeper meanings of the subject. They ask more questions. They are more inquisitive to understand the subject matter more thoroughly. So they may even meet the teacher in beyond the class hours also. Okay. So naturally, teacher is more inclined towards those students. Teacher is more attending to those students. And teacher may have a special inclination and special love for such students also. Because these students are those people who are taking the studies very seriously. Okay. And they want to learn more. Teacher will naturally reveal more knowledge to such students. And within the classroom also, although teacher is giving the same lecture to everyone, some people are spaced out. Some people are not very attentive. Some people are sleeping. So it's the student's mistake. Teacher is saying. So similarly, Krishna also is equal to all living entities. But there are some people who specially worship him. There are millions and millions of people in this world. How many are worshipping Krishna? So, Krishna is equal to all of them. Krishna stays as Paramatma in every living entity's heart. Samoham sarvabhuteshu. Ishvara sarvabhutanam hriddeshe arjuna tishthati. Krishna stays within the heart of everybody. And Krishna also says that sarvasya chaham hridisannivishto mattaha smritir jnanam apohanam cha. I am staying within the heart of every single living being and I am giving them forgetfulness, I am giving them remembrance, I am giving them knowledge. So, to that degree, Krishna is equal to everyone as super soul. He is neutral. Witness. He sanctions our desires. He notes our desires. He sanctions our desires. He facilitates the fulfillment of those desires through prakriti. All that he will do. But when you become a devotee of Krishna, when you worship Krishna, Krishna will do much more than super soul. He will not act like Paramatma. He will act like Bhagavan. So Paramatma is a neutral witness, and he sanctions things. And Bhagavan is very personal and reciprocal with the mood and intent of his devotees. So to that degree, Krishna is reciprocal. Krishna is like a cloud that rains everywhere equally, whether it is on land or rock or water. Rain just falls. Rain doesn't discriminate. But for devotees, he gives specific attention. So there is no, it's not discrimination. It is natural. Just like a charitable person also is equally disposed to everyone who is coming to him for charity, a donor. But definitely, the charitable person is more specially inclined towards his own children, isn't it? So his own sons, he will give special inclination. He gives charity to anyone. A poor person is coming, I need something, I need some 10 dresses, I don't have. I need some jewels, I need some grains, I need some vegetables. So the charitable person will give. But towards his own children, son or daughter, this donor will give special attention. And another sloka which is very much connected to this theme is Yathamam Prapadyante Tamstataiva Bhajamyaham. You know that sloka, fourth chapter. So now, second point is Maite Teshu Chapyaham. I am there in them, they are there in me. Or I am their friend and they are my friend. Okay. So Prabhupada writes here, the Lord says here distinctly, Maite, they are in me. Naturally, as a result, the Lord is also in them. This is reciprocal. This also explains the word Yathamam Prapadyante. This transcendental reciprocation exists because both the Lord and the devotee are conscious. When a diamond is set in a golden ring, it looks very nice. The gold is glorified, and at the same time, diamond is also glorified. Now we have a golden ring without any diamond there. The groove is empty. That ring doesn't look very appealing. It doesn't look very nice or shiny because the diamond is missing there. It just fell off. You know, the diamond fell down, we pick up that diamond. It may look beautiful. This golden ring is also looking beautiful, but with diamond, its beauty is increased and you pick up that diamond. You may lose it also, you may not be able to appreciate it. But when the diamond is just inserted in this that groove in the ring, the shining of the diamond will increase, the beauty of the gold also will increase. So they are like complementing each other. Okay. Similarly, the Lord is a diamond, and so this combination is very nice. Living entities in a pure state are called devotees. The Supreme Lord becomes the devotee of his devotees. If a reciprocal relationship is not present between the devotee and the Lord, there is no personalist philosophy only. Okay. So these are the points. Okay. Next, 30th sloka. So Krishna described how bhakti is so simple. Patram pushpam phalantoya. You offer anything with love and devotion, I accept. Fine. Next, Krishna says, if you can't offer things to me with love and devotion, at least offer things to me. Whatever you have, you just offer. That is yatkaroshya darshanashi. If you do so, eventually you will develop your bhakti, you will come to me also. That is 20th sloka. 29th sloka, Krishna says, I am equal to everyone, but I am specially inclined to my devotees. Okay, my special inclination towards my devotees is spoken in 29th verse. Now, what if those devotees do some mistakes? If a devotee performs some mistake or sinful activity, or he becomes durachar, a person who exhibits some, you know, bad character or bad activity, what will Krishna do with such people? Krishna describes in the next two slokas.
Here Krishna says,
even if one commits the most abominable action, a devotee of Krishna happens to commit a very abominable activity or some sinful activity, but bhajate mam ananya bhak, but if he is engaged in devotional service of Krishna ananya without any deviation, then sadhureva samantavyah, I consider him as a sadhu, a saintly devotee of mine. So Krishna says, I consider a devotee who has done some mistake also as a saintly person. Okay. Why? Samyak vyavasito hi saha. He is properly fixed in his determination in me. That does not mean that anyone who is performing bhakti has license to do all sinful activities. That is not the message there. If a devotee happens to do some mistake, incidentally, not intentionally, accidentally or circumstantially he does some mistake, not purposefully in a premeditated way. These are all different. So intentionally doing a mistake and incidentally doing mistake, they are different. Okay. Now, for example, you perform devotional service incidentally. What is the definition of pure devotional service? Anya bhilashita sunyam jnana karma adi anavrutam anukulyena krishna anushilanam. You perform bhakti with favorable intent. You intend to perform bhakti. Your intention is to please Krishna by doing some seva to Krishna. Then you definitely get a positive result of that performance of service. Krishna, you will definitely get Krishna's mercy. But you just happen to, for example, you are going, so another devotee is there. He is on the other side of the property. He is 1 kilometer away from you. And he needs a book. You need to give this book to him. You have no other agenda there. Okay. So you go from here, stopping your work, pick up this book, walk 1 kilometer in hot sun, in summer, and then give this book to the devotee and then come back. So the devotee is impressed. Oh, you have taken out a lot of time and energy. You interrupted your whatever activity that you are doing and then you have specifically come to give me this book because I am in need of this book. He'll be specially grateful to you. Now you're sitting here and he needs the book. You got a phone call. And somebody just happened, some guest or somebody is just going in that cart, electric cart. Okay, you just take it and put it in this room, put in his hand. Okay, you just take it and one fellow is standing there, he will come and collect from you. So he anyways is going towards that main gate and you just give him. And the person will collect, the devotee who called you for the book, he will collect. And then he may thank that person who brought it. Because he did not do any specific endeavor. Okay. Incidentally, he is just going towards that side and then he got to send the book also, give the book also. So it's an incidental service, not intentional service. If you intentionally perform service to the Lord with a favorable intent, then you get more mercy. But if you incidentally happen to perform something, still you will get some mercy, but not as much as when you do service with a sincere intent, right? This is clear? Similarly, means if you do a good activity incidentally and if you do the same good activity intentionally, the results are slightly different. They're not exactly the same. The task may seem the same, but they're a little different in terms of giving you results. Similarly, if you incidentally perform a sinful activity, the repercussions are a little less. But if you intentionally perform a sinful activity, the results are much more severe. Okay. So that's why when you say that apiche sudurachara, that sudurachara means an abominable activity performed by a devotee is not supposed to be done intentionally or purposefully or in a premeditated way. It just happens out of circumstances. Incidentally, accidentally, or because of some force of some previous habit or some other impression, something like that. Okay, these are all accidental mistakes. Okay. Bhakti is a Prabhupada writes, bhakti is like declaration of war against Maya. As long as one is not perfect, one will fall down. In our attempts to perform devotional service by controlling our mind and senses, sometimes there could be a failure. Okay. So that failure should not take us into depression or dejection, or we should not be demotivated or discouraged, okay, or disheartened. That should give us a caution note that Maya is very powerful, and with a deeper commitment and determination, we should again try to continue to practice bhakti without getting demotivated. Okay, so we are not perfect. We cannot. There are so many frailties and shortcomings and anarthas still there. So one should fight against those anarthas while taking shelter of Krishna. And in one's fight, one may sometimes lose also, because the opponent is very powerful. Maya is very powerful. We are very weak. Prabhupada writes, bhakti is like declaration of war against Maya. As long as one is not perfect, there may be accidental fall downs from the path of saintly character. However, the circumstantial despicable activities of Krishna's devotee due to the power of material impressions does not make him abominable. Just as spots on the moon do not become impediment and diffusion of light. Moon has some spots, but still there is moonlight. On a Purnami day, the full moon gives you light, is it not? There are some spots. Is it like darkness is totally gone or what? The light is not at all coming out or what? It's still coming. Similarly, one should understand that a sincere devotee does not perform mistakes or sinful activities with a purpose, with a pre-planned or premeditated manner. So sometimes accidentally, circumstantially, something could happen. Okay. Krishna is willing to forgive. Why you are paralyzing? Krishna is considering him saintly devotee. How can you be so unkind and harsh to such a devotee? Why? Because bhajate mam ananya bhakti is a very important line. Okay. If the devotee is engaged in sincere devotional service without any deviation, then he is considered a saintly devotee. Not anyone and everyone who is whimsically doing anything purposefully, then he is not sadhuryava samantabhya. Mistake is accidental and he is continuing to perform bhakti. Then such a person can be, you know, forgiven. Now you see this. क्षिप्रं भवति धर्मात्मा
क्षिप्रं भवति धर्मात्मा
शश्वत शान्तिं निगच्छति
शश्वत शान्तिं निगच्छति
कौन्तेय प्रतिजानीहि
कौन्तेय प्रतिजानीहि
नमे भक्तः प्रणश्यति
नमे भक्तः प्रणश्यति
क्षिप्रं भवति धर्मात्मा ही विल क्विकली बिकम राइचियस ही विल अगेन कम बैक टू हिज ओरिजिनल मूड एज अ सेंटली पर्सन क्षिप्रं भवति धर्मात्मा शश्वत शांतिम निगच्छति ही विल अटेन एवरलास्टिंग पीस नो डाउट अबाउट इट ओ कौन्तेय ओ माय डियर अर्जुन कौन्तेय प्रतिजानी ही नमे भक्तः प्रणश्यति जस्ट अनाउंस टू द होल वर्ल्ड दैट माय डिवोटी विल नेवर पेरिश ओके सो लाइक दैट कृष्णा एक्सक्यूजेस ए डिवोटी कृष्णा प्यूरिफाइज ए डिवोटी इवन इफ ए डिवोटी समटाइम्स हैपेंस टू डू समथिंग रॉन्ग दैट्स द होल थीम ऑफ The sixth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. What is the theme? Poshanam. Even if a devotee happens to transgress some codes of dharma, still the Lord is very kind to such a devotee, provided the devotee continues to perform bhakti with all sincerity. Okay. Because when a devotee does a mistake, he repents for the mistake. There is repentance there. When a devotee commits sin, the devotee does not justify the mistake. The devotee repents for the sin committed and he feels disgust for his actions and he will regret, he will repent and he will try not to repeat and he will remember the mistake. Sometimes we may do some mistake and after that we may not repeat that mistake, but we can remember the mistake. Because tomorrow if you do something very good, people are glorifying you left, right, center. Okay, then one will become proud of one's abilities to do something good. But in such circumstances where so many people are glorifying you and you are feeling proud, if you just look back, what did I do some time back? Just 1 month back, I became angry with so and so person. I became very lusty 10 days back. I became too greedy 2 weeks back. So if you remember those incidents, it could be beneficial in protecting you from pride. Okay. So devotee remembers the mistake just to humble himself. I am not perfect. Because by remembrance of such mistakes, we can be grateful to Krishna, we can be grateful to devotees. Because if we remember our fallen condition before, now we can be grateful to those devotees who brought out of the fallen condition. I was so fallen like this. I did so many sinful activities. From that pool of sinful impressions, I am pulled out. And I am being situated in this position by the grace of Krishna and devotees. You can be grateful. But if one son, Prabhupada writes like this in one purport, if one completely forgets one sinful background, he may not find a reason to be grateful to those people who brought him to bhakti like this. He may not acknowledge Krishna's grace because of which he overcome that sinful background. You see? So a devotee is not a person who never does a mistake. A devotee, sincere devotee, I'm speaking about practitioners, not perfected people. Perfected devotees, they will never do any mistakes, of course. But practicing devotees, they are not those people who never do any mistakes. They are sincere people who may do some mistakes circumstantially, accidentally, but they don't justify those mistakes. They regret for them honestly. They try not to repeat those mistakes, and they remember those mistakes and try to rectify those mistakes and take shelter of Krishna sincerely and pray to Krishna to overcome those mistakes and then continue on the path of devotional service. So, but those people who are doing mistake in a premeditated way, purposefully, and justifying those mistakes, not admitting those mistakes, and trying to pose themselves as great people, although they have a lot of sinful background. So such people are pretenders. They are mithyacharis. But there are some honest mistakes. Okay. So those mistakes are forgiven by the Lord. So this verse of Krishna should not be a license to us to behave very whimsically or irresponsibly or purposefully commit mistakes. Ajamil has done so many sinful activities, but he was not doing it on the strength of devotional service. He chanted Narayana, Narayana, not to nullify his sinful reactions. But he was not committing sins, not because he was thinking that Narayana, I'm chanting Narayana, that will take care of my sinful activities, sinful reactions. Not like that. Ajamila's performance of sinful activities and his chanting of Narayana are two different things. He never mixed them. It's an offense to mix these two. Okay. So, point is, I am doing bhakti, I have license to behave whimsically. That's the biggest mistake. You are doing bhakti, somehow by mistake, some sin you have committed accidentally, and you regretted for it sincerely, you repented for it very honestly, you tried not to repeat it, and you tried to rectify it, and you remembered it, and you remained humble. So then, this devotional service will protect you. Okay? So, because Krishna is so attached to his devotee, just be, after spending a lot of time waste in uselessly in this material world, a conditioned soul somehow came to the process of bhakti. And in this, while performing this process of bhakti, he happens to do some small mistake. Will Krishna lose him? Definitely not. Every devotee who comes into this realm of bhakti yoga is very valuable for Krishna. Krishna gives a lot of importance and value to such devotees. Just because he has some shortcoming or he has done some mistake, why will Krishna lose him? Krishna will not lose him. That is Krishna's nature. He is my man. He went through 84 lakh species and came to human species, and then finally he came to bhakti yoga. He associated with my devotees, and poor fellow, he has done some mistake because of some bad habit or some other impression or some accidentally he has done. So Why would I lose him? He is an honest person. Like that. So this is not speaking about hypocritic people. This verse is about honest mistakes, not hypocritic mistakes.
Same verse okay. Is in the Divine Canto.
Huh?
Same verse. Svapadam do bhajato priyasya.
Ah, exactly.
Tetanna bhavrishya.
Correct. That attachment does not decrease even if a devotee commits wrong. Krishna is attached to devotees. Just like a child may be mischievous, but the mother is kind to the child. Mother's attachment to the child will not go down just because the child is doing some mischief or the child is little naughty. Okay. So, but taking advantage of Krishna's kindness, devotee should not intentionally commit mistakes. That's an important point. And Krishna asked Arjuna to declare this nature of Krishna because Krishna knows that when a devotee declares something about Krishna, other people will take it more seriously than when Krishna himself declares. Of course, devotees take Krishna's words very seriously, no doubt about it. But Krishna gives that much importance and value to his devotees. You declare, okay? Even if people doubt me in different ways, but they will not doubt my devotees. You declare, okay? So, Krishna will uphold the declaration made by his devotee under all circumstances. Because if a devotee promises somebody, Krishna is obliged to deliver. Narada Muni wanted Nalakuvar and Manigriva to receive Krishna's mercy. Krishna gave them mercy. Ambarish wanted that Krishna should show some mercy to Durvasa Muni. Sudarshan stopped cutting the head of Durvasa Muni. Okay? So when a devotee prays for us, Krishna listens to that prayer more than when we pray directly. Durvasa Muni directly prayed to Narayana. Nothing happened. And Durvasa Muni fell at the feet of Ambarish Maharaj and something happened. Okay? Because Krishna gives more importance to the words of his devotees than he gives importance to his own self. That's why he says, Kaunteya prachijanihi name bhakta pranasyati. You tell, my devotee will never perish. Arjuna, you should declare. Krishna gives importance to devotees. Like that, Krishna reveals his heart in this chapter. In this 9th chapter of Gita, which is considered very confidential, the middle 6 chapters, 7th chapter to 12th chapter, the middle 6 chapters of Gita are the essence of Gita. Okay? They are very confidential. And in the middle 6 chapters, the middle 2 chapters, 9 and 10, they are most confidential, the confidential part of the confidential part. In this 2 chapters, Krishna reveals his heart so much. All these 9th chapter verses. And 10th chapter in the beginning verses, all this. Next. So bhakti unto Krishna basically does not consider incidental faults arising by actions of misbehaving devotee. But bhakti does not even consider inherent faults of a person which arise from his very birth also. Okay. Now there are incidental faults, there are inherent faults. Incidental faults are you have acquired some bad habits in this life. And you came to bhakti process. And those bad habits are still haunting you. So, then out of that you have done some mistake. Krishna will forgive that. Okay? Provided you are sincere in taking his shelter and then you are trying to rectify them and then come out of them. Fine. But there are inherent faults which cannot be changed throughout the life. Which come by birth only. Okay? So, just like the birth of a person also comes along with certain faults. Somebody may be born as a lame man. I mean, spiritually it's not a fault. After all, that is material body. Somebody is low born in a low family, in a, say, mediator family or some other family. So, that is fault on a social plane, not on a spiritual plane. So, bhakti does not consider these faults on a external plane also. That's what is mentioned in the next sloka. माम हि पार्थम व्यपाश्रित्य
माम हि पार्थम व्यपाश्रित्य
येपि स्युः पापयोनयः
येपि स्युः पापयोनयः
स्त्रियो वैश्यास्तथा शूद्राः
स्त्रियो वैश्यास्तथा शूद्राः
येपि यान्ति परां गतिं
येपि यान्ति परां गतिं.
So in this shloka Krishna says, माम हि पार्थम व्यपाश्रित्य, ओ सन ऑफ पार्थ, दोस हू टेक शेल्टर ऑफ मी आश्रित्या. येपि स्युः पापयोनयः, इवन इफ दे आर बॉर्न इन ए सिनफुल स्पीशीज, ओके, even if they are so sinful in their birth, not activity, in birth, then Striyo Vaishyas Tatha Shudraha, Striyaha means woman, Vaishyaha means merchants, Shudra means workers, low class people. So they are not considered in the Vedic society, in the olden society, they are not considered that great. Like Brahmanas are considered greater than Vaishyas. Okay. So this kind of physical, bodily and social related frailties in people are actually no consideration for bhakti. Okay. Tepa yanti param gatim, even women also can go to spiritual destination, Krishna's lotus feet. Even Vaishyas also can do that. Even Shudras also can do that. Striyaha Vaishyas Tata Shudraha. These people also can go. Okay. So one should not, this shloka is such a broad-minded shloka that one should not look down upon one caste or one creed or one nation or one community or one gender. So one should not have all these kind of external differences. Bhakti does not consider the differences. Bhagavan does not consider the difference. Bhaktas don't consider these differences. Why other people are bothered so much about it? Whether you are a man or woman, it doesn't matter to Krishna. If you have sincere devotion, Krishna will accept you. Okay? Whether you are a Brahmana or a Shudra, it doesn't matter to Krishna. Krishna clearly says. Whether you are an honest servant of when you are an honest king, Kshatriya, or a merchant, Krishna doesn't consider that. Striyo Vaishyas Tatha Shudraha. There are some people who may look down upon Stri. There are some people who may look down upon Vaishya and Shudra. Okay, fanatic people. But Bhakti is not fanatic. Krishna is not fanatic. Krishna's devotee should not be fanatic. That's the message given here. Okay. So don't judge a person, don't disrespect a person considering the person's caste or wealth or birth or gender or anything like that. That's very great offense. So Krishna says none of these people are eliminated from receiving my mercy. I am merciful to all of them. Okay. So Prabhupada says that there are two kinds of activities. One is conditional activity, one is constitutional activity. As far as protecting the body or abiding by the rules of society and state, certainly there are different activities, even for the devotees in connection with conditioned life, and such activities are called conditional. Besides these conditional activities, the living entity who is fully conscious of spiritual nature and is engaged in Krishna consciousness, so that activity is transcendental activity. So as spirit souls we have certain activity, as people dwelling in material bodies under some material circumstances, we have certain activities. Okay, so these two are very different. Okay, conditional and constitutional. So one needs to give more importance to constitutional activity than conditional activity. So similarly, one should also look at other people from a perspective of their constitutional position than conditional position. In this conditioned world, somebody may be born as a born in low family, poor family, not very well educated. So one should not have such discriminations. So one should understand that bhakti is universal, it's meant for everyone. Krishna is not considering this being a Stri Sudra, Dvijabandhu or Vaishya or Sudra as disqualification for bhakti. But the psychophysical natures that are acquired by living entities under these certain conditions need to be acknowledged in our general behavior. We need to maintain distance. Okay, two opposite genders cannot freely mix. So that kind of respectful distance need to be maintained. That does not lead to disrespect. That should not lead to disrespect. Okay. So Krishna is presenting a very broad-minded perspective. This whole series of verses. No distinction between lower and higher classes of people. Therefore, devotional service and guidance of a pure devotee are so strong that there is no discrimination between the lower and higher classes of men. Anyone can take to it. The most simple man taking shelter of a pure devotee can be purified by proper guidance. According to the different modes of material nature, Men are classified into different modes, Kshatriyas, Brahmanas, Sudras, etc., etc. But no one is disqualified for bhakti. So, now the process of bhakti and the association of Krishna's devotees is so powerful that people from sinful backgrounds also can be purified. A person who is born in a sinful and low family, of even dog eater's family also, can be purified, provided he takes the shelter of devotees and Krishna and the process of bhakti yoga. But a person who is born in a Brahmana family with all the great qualities, they cannot be purified if they don't take the bhakti. Simple. Krishna does not see whether you are a man or a woman or a Brahmana or a Kshatriya or a Vaishya or a Sudra. Krishna sees whether you have devotee, you are a devotee or not. Naham vipro nacha narapatir napi vaishyo na sudro. Naham varani nacha grahapatir na vanastho yatirva. Kintu prodyan nikhila paramananda puranamrita adher gopi bhartuhu padakamalayor dasa 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 anudasa. The designation as the constitutional position of every living entity is to be a servant of the servant of the servant of Krishna. So one should not consider these differences. With Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, Stri, Purusha, children, old men. So these are not the real considerations. That's why Prahlada says, Manye dhana bhijana rupa tapashrita ujaha teja prabhava balapaurusha buddhi yoga naradhanaya hi bhavanti parasya pumso bhaktyatu tosha bhagavan gajayutha bhaya. Manye dhana abhijana rupa tapa shruta oja. These are all different qualities. Prahlada describes 12 qualities of elevated people, advanced people, great brahmanas. Dhana, wealth, abhijana, followers, rupa, beauty, tapa, austerity, shruta, education, oja, physical strength, bodily strength, mental strength, intellectual strength. All these things are not impressive to Krishna. Okay, naradhanaya hi bhavanti parasya pumso. These are not the right qualifications or prerequisites to be able to worship Krishna. Krishna is pleased only by this. Bhaktya tutosha bhagavan gajayutha paya. Only bhakti can satisfy Krishna. And if that bhakti is exhibited even by an elephant also, like Gajendra, Krishna is pleased. Okay. So, Sriyo Vaishyas Tatha Shudraha Tipi Yanti Parangati. They also can attain back to Godhead. They can also can go back to Godhead. Okay. Ultimately, now you see, in the according to constitutional position of living entity, everybody is a female only. Okay. Prakriti. There is only one Purusha, Krishna. Everyone else is Prakriti. Jivas are Prakriti. Okay. So, what is that sloka? Mamai Vamsho Jiva Loke, Jiva Bhuta. No, not even that. We read in the 7th chapter of Bhagavad Gita that Aparaya Mitastvanyam Prakritim Vidhime Param. Okay. Jiva Bhuta Mahabaho Eyedam Dharyate Jagat. So, this Jiva Bhutas, Jivas are Prakritim Vidhime Param. They are also Prakriti. They are also energies of the Lord. Jiva is not Purusha. Jiva is Prakriti. Feminine in nature. Purusha is masculine and Jiva is feminine. Okay. So there is only one Purusha Krishna. He is the supreme enjoyer. All others are enjoyed. So whether the Jiva is in a male body or a female body in this world, constitutional nature is to be feminine only. To be the Prakriti only. Enjoyed only. Fine. That is the original position. Everybody is quote unquote female. But in the conditioned nature, everybody is male only. Why? A conditioned jiva has Purusha mentality, Purusha bhava. Whether the conditioned jiva is in a male body or female body, the enjoyership mentality is there. I am the enjoyer, I am the controller, I am the master, I am the proprietor. That feelings are there even in women, even in men, even in a transgender. Even in an animal, bird, any species, any gender you take, the mentality of being a Purusha, the controller mentality is there. Thus, according to constitutional position, everybody is a female. According to conditional position, everybody is a male. Okay. Now, who is the stree here? Okay. But ultimately speaking, soul is neither male nor female in the ultimate sense. Soul is a servant of Krishna. Jivera Swarupuhai Krishnera Nityadas. Every single soul is a servant of Krishna. Some servants are in male bodies, some servants are in female bodies according to the nature of the service, according to the nature of the person who wants to do specific service. That's all. So to that degree, these differences are quite superficial. But as long as this jiva is entrapped within the material body, these differences need to be acknowledged. The psychophysical nature is acquired by a person by being in certain body, in certain species, need to be acknowledged. But another important factor along with this acknowledgement is, one can overcome all this by taking shelter of bhakti. We need to understand the transcendental spiritual perspective also. We need to acknowledge the current material circumstances also and perform bhakti. Is it clear? Fine. 33rd sloka. किं पुनर्ब्राह्मणाः पुण्याम्
किं पुनर्ब्राह्मणाः पुण्याम्
भक्ता राजर्षयस्तथा
भक्ता राजर्षयस्तथा
अनित्यम सुखं लोकम्
अनित्यम सुखं लोकम्
इमं प्राप्य भजस्व माम्
इमं प्राप्य भजस्व माम्
किं पुनर्ब्राह्मणाः पुण्याम् इन द प्रीवियस श्लोक कृष्ण स्पोक अबाउट वैश्यस एंड शूद्रस दे आर कंसीडर्ड लोअर इवन दे आर क्वालिफाइड टू कम टू माय abode, if they perform bhakti, Krishna says that. Now, if they are qualified, what to speak of brahmanas and rajarshis? Kim punar brahmanaha punya? Generally, brahmanas are very pious. Then, bhakta rajarshayastatha, great rajarshis. Rajas means kings. But he is not speaking about only rajas. He is speaking about rajarshis. Means saintly kings. They are saints amongst kings. What to speak of kshatriyas who are very saintly, and what to speak of brahmanas who are very pious? If people who are born in sinful species, striya, vaishya, sudra, if they are qualified to come to my abode by performing bhakti, what to speak of pious brahmanas and saintly kings? Anitya vasukham lokam imam prapya bhajaswamam. They will give up this anitya and asukha loka. Anitya means temporary. Nitya is permanent, anitya means temporary. Asukha. Sukha is happiness, asukha is distress. So giving up this material world which is full of distress and which is so temporary, they will come to my abode. Provided they are devotees, bhakta. Otherwise, even if you are a brahmana or a kshatriya, it's not necessary that you go back to Godhead. Because that is not the qualification. If bhakti is there, that is the qualification. And being a shudra and vaishya, it's not a disqualification. If there is no bhakti, there is disqualification. So this being a brahmana, kshatriya, vaishya, shudra, they are not the qualifications or disqualifications for performing bhakti. They are just external situations that a conditioned soul acquires because of previous activities, good or bad activities. But one can overcome the effects of those previous good or bad activities provided they take shelter of bhakti. Is it clear? Krishna is very systematically speaking now. Now he concludes the whole chapter with this sloka, last sloka of this chapter, which is considered the essence of Bhagavad Gita. And Krishna repeats this sloka in the 18th chapter also. 9th chapter he said, 18th chapter also he says that. Manmana bhava mad bhakto,
manmana bhava mad bhakto,
madhyaji imam namaskuru,
madhyaji imam namaskuru,
mame vaishyasi yuktvaivam,
mame vaishyasi yuktvaivam,
आत्मानं मत्परायणः
आत्मानं मत्परायणः
मन्मना means always thinking of Krishna भवमत भक्तो become a devotee of Krishna मद्याजी worship Krishna माम नमस्कुरु offer नमस्कार or dandavats obeisances to Krishna मामेव इष्यसि उक्त्वैवम् if you do so if you do these four things Four things are thinking of Krishna, becoming a devotee of Krishna, worshipping Krishna and doing namaskara to Krishna. If you do this, Mame Vaishyas, you will definitely come back to me. Why? Yuktvaivam, because you are so absorbed in me. Atmanam matparayanaha, you have completely dedicated yourself to me. Matparayanaha, you are completely absorbed in me, dedicated to me, so you will definitely come back to me. It's my promise. Just do this. Sufficient. Bhakti, like river Ganga, does not consider who is suitable and unsuitable. Anybody can take bath in Ganga. And Ganga will destroy the sins of people who take shelter of Ganga. So similarly, bhakti also will destroy all the sinful proclivities in people if we take shelter of bhakti. So this is a very important instruction of Bhagavad Gita. Okay, very important instruction. Man mana bhavamad bhakto madhyaji mam namaskur. So you can read the details of this shloka in the purport. So to summarize the whole section, today we discussed the last section of 9th chapter, 26th shloka to 34th shloka, where Krishna describes the glories of Bhakti Yoga. In the 26th shloka, Krishna said, Patram Pushpam Phalam Toyam. Whatever you offer, with devotion, I will accept. Okay? And even if somebody does not have devotion, still, whatever they do, they can still offer to Krishna. That he says in the 27th verse. Yat karoshi yadashnasi, tat kurushva madarpanam. Offer it to me. So 27th verse is not pure bhakti like 26, but still 27 is also very great bhakti. At least, even if you are, if you don't have pure bhakti to Krishna, you are offering everything that you are doing to Krishna, that is good. If you do so, then you will attain Krishna. You will be detached. So that is the 28th verse. In the 29th verse, Krishna said that I am equal to all in general, but I am specially inclined to my devotees. And what if those devotees do some mistake? 30th and 31st shlokas, Krishna says that I excuse those devotees because they continue to do my devotional service and their mistakes are also accidental, not incidental, not intentional. Okay, and they will be reinstated in devotional service, don't worry. Even if they do some mistakes also, I protect them, don't worry. Okay, that's not a license for them to do mistakes, but they do circumstantially, then I will forgive them. So Arjuna, you declare that my devotee will never perish. Okay, if a devotee performs some mistakes, you will forgive and then protect the devotee. So they are intentional, incidental mistakes. What if a devotee does he is not doing intentional or incidental mistakes, he is sinful in his birth only. Okay, then Krishna says, no, birth doesn't matter to me. Whether they are stri, vaishya or shudra, I will definitely deliver them. Okay, so what to speak of qualified people like brahmanas and other rajarshis, I will certainly deliver them. The conclusion is, become my devotee, worship me. Okay, so this is how Krishna concludes the chapter. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai, Jada Prabhupada ki jai. Next.